Hi, everyone. Welcome to a special edition of 30 Minutes to Better Health. This young gentleman sitting next to me is Dr. Steven Margolis, Sterling Heights, Michigan. Dr. Margolis, I have been familiar with we're talking decades now. And one of the more popular shows we've always done, we do a lot of things here, and it's about patient education. We try to put out conventional things, unconventional things, but we're trying to educate people. But I can tell you with certainty, you were probably the first medical doctor, DO, medical doctor, you're an MD, I believe,
yes.
MD, that I had ever heard that, and I like this analogy, that had two drawers at your disposal. You had the conventional medical doctor drawer, the kind of one that I grew up seeing as a child, that there was a doctor over in, I don't know if you were in Sterling Heights then.
Yes. But,
Same location?
No.
Okay. Well, before we forget, we're on Mound between Hall Road and 19. But I had been hearing about this Dr. Margolis. And I remember a couple reasons that you stood out. Number one is your name, Margolis. Margolius. You know, people would kind of get confused. Your name is Stephen. My middle name is Stephen, spelled the PH way is mine. But I started hearing that there was this doctor, but I didn't know you existed. Back in my world of education, we were taught quite a bit, relatively speaking, nutritional, which is actually very limited now compared to the knowledge that's out there. As you know, 35 years later, 34 years later.
They still don't teach it in medical school.
And what we were taught, even though there was an effort, but it was more the conventional, the easy stuff, the simple stuff. You know, it was the letter vitamins we were taught, maybe some mineral things, the very basic. But to have somebody like you in your world that actually delved into that to the degree I was hearing, but you said, and I was doing some research on you, and you said we're going to get into bioidentical hormones, and you being the expert on it, we'll let you talk about exactly what that is. But Dr. Margolis, let's talk about, number one, your interest in healthcare, how you are kind of unique in healthcare, and let's hear it from the expert, one of the leading experts, not only in this area, Macomb County, but in the country, because you do lecture all over, I've heard,
yes,
out of state. But let's talk about some of your focuses. What makes you so unique and some of your real interests in care? A medical doctor is exposed, especially a primary family doctor like yourself, exposed to a lot of things. Let's talk about just an exhaustive overview, if you will, of exactly why we're here, why I heard about you 20 to 30 years ago, probably 30 years ago, actually. And let's talk to the people at home. One of the main or multiple reasons why they would consult with you, how you're a little different.
Okay.
As far as your approach to health.
Well, I'm pleased to tell you, in 1990, they had a program through the American Heart Association to train family physicians to be cholesterol specialists. So I went through that. I did a fellowship at the University of Iowa. And then I brought some pretty cutting-edge things to Macomb County, which we'll talk about, for cholesterol testing and treatment improvements for patients' health. In 1990, also, alternative medicine, as you said, was virtually unheard of, especially in a conservative county like Macomb County. So at that time, I was working for St. Joseph's Hospital, and they asked me to do an alternative medicine lecture in the hospital conference room for about 20 people. The topic was of such interest to the citizens of Macomb County that it turned into 300 to 400 people, and they actually did a satellite feed with Bill Bonds, who our older viewers will remember, the former anchorman for Channel 7. So he was patched in to do a live satellite to St. Joseph's Hospital in Macomb for alternative medicine, and nobody expected it to be so popular among residents. And I've been running with it since, and as you said, I've been doing bioidentical hormones since 1990.
And what exactly is that?
So bioidentical hormones are actually very interesting. A lot of patients don't want the synthetic Premarin or progesterones because of the side effects. As you probably know, there were studies, the Women's Health Initiative, that showed a higher incidence of breast cancer and events in patients who were on the synthetic hormones as opposed to the natural. Bioidentical hormones come from plants. They're compounded by a compounding pharmacy. They're much safer and in many cases more efficacious. And I'll introduce you to a patient, Mary, who had no success with the synthetic hormones and is doing remarkably well on the bioidentical hormones.
I can tell you your average patient, your average new patient, would be somebody either that doesn't want, like you had said, a lot of the side effects, but I can tell you my average patient, and I'm sure yours as well, weren't necessarily success stories. They're the unsuccessful stories. You know, the ones that, let's just say, curtain number one didn't give the desired outcomes, whether it be that, you know, their symptoms didn't abate at all, or, you know, there was too many side effects. then they come to you for curtain number two or maybe three. Would that be your average patient? You know, somebody that's, you know, maybe failed somewhere else.
Well, we have that. And as you said, we have patients who failed either synthetic or bioidentical hormones elsewhere, because the way that I do the bioidentical hormones is I trained under Jonathan Wright, who was the inventor of bioidentical hormones in the 70s. And we use his lab, which is way more accurate than most other labs. And we do 24-hour urine testing, which I can show you a report, how comprehensive it is. It's much more accurate than blood or saliva. So we're getting measurements that really have great applications for the patients, where I can tell the compounding pharmacist exactly how much of each ingredient to put in with unprecedented accuracy.
I remember this guy went and had some tests, and he was worried about his organs with issues. And I guess his blood test came out totally normal. And the reason I'm saying this is about your 24-hour, and you clean it up as you see. But I remember a friend of mine, again, this wasn't even in the state of Michigan, we were down south, and he took my blood. He asked me, I don't take steroids, I don't care about it, but he took mine and tested it. He worked in a lab. And my enzymes were absolutely atrocious. I mean, I was 23, 24 years old. I mean, they were off the chart. I mean, I would have been like the worst steroid abuser in the world, I guess, at that point. But what we didn't figure out, we figured it out a little bit later. I had just worked out.
Right.
And, you know, all the tissue breakdown, as you know, my hands, you know, went out of sight.
Well,
would that 24-hour kind of be different than a...
They don't measure those enzymes on a 24-hour urine.
Equivalent of that, though. Would you pick up? It'd be out of
like. Well, the problem is, for example, when you're measuring a testosterone level, people don't realize you're supposed to do it before 10 in the morning, because there's a normal curve to testosterone secretion. And if you do it late in the afternoon, you get a false reading. Similarly, if you only do one blood test, you're getting one number, what it is at that point in time. When you're doing a 24-hour urine, you're averaging it out over 24 hours, so you're getting multiple specimens
and
a much more accurate number.
I just worked out, so all of a sudden.
Right.
And that's.
You never want to do it right after working out.
I didn't get that memo. You know, so I'm like, oh,
well,
how can this
since
be
we're talking about a 24-hour urine, let me show you what it looks like. So patients who do the 24-hour urine get this very comprehensive report, and in it they look at multiple types of estrogens, progesterones, testosterone, and all the adrenal hormones. Adrenal burnout is such a common problem in our stressed out society that not only are all the adrenal hormones listed for the patient and measured so we can supplement accordingly, but they also generate graphs. And I'm sure you're familiar with the 4-point cortisol curves, where we can see a patient's cortisol levels at different times during the day, their melatonin levels to see if they need help, you know, with sleep, and their steroid hormones are all effectively plotted out. So this gives a ton of information. And then the lab, Dr. Wright's lab, provides these references for patients to be able to see not only how the hormones are produced, but also, you know, explanations of what hormone is, each one is, so a patient knows what and why they're supplementing. And these are just some of the resources we have available to the patients for bioidentical hormones.
I remember I took the blood test. It was late. This fellow is a friend of mine from school, the guy that worked in the lab. Yeah, 11 o'clock or something at night. So let's just go by a standard time frame. So let's say I worked out, in this case, instead of 9 o'clock at night, I worked out at 9 o'clock in the morning and went and had that done at 10, the conventional way.
Yes.
And this is about the accuracy of this. Does this give you an average of the 24 hours, or do they do it at specific times of the day? I mean, how do they,
okay,
you know, 24 hours, what does that mean?
So that's a good question. There's two ways to do the 24-hour urine testing. This is the newer technology called dried urine testing, when the patient takes a strip and dips it in their urine at four different times during the day to generate the 4 points on the curve. It's not a continuous collection during the day. The gold standard, which is even more accurate, is a patient collects every drop of urine they produce for 24 hours in a giant jug, and then they pour a portion of it off in a smaller container and send it to the lab with information about how much was in the big jug, how much is in the small jug, so they can do their calculations. That is slightly more accurate. But for new patients, we've been doing this 4-point testing at four different times because it's easier, it's less expensive, and almost as accurate, and it gives more information for the adrenal hormones, which is such an important problem for patients in today's busy world.
Yeah, the fight or flight hormones. So yes. That would be like mid-afternoon fatigue. What would be some of the symptoms?
And again, that would be measured at noon and 4 p.m. And a lot of patients pursue bioidentical hormone testing because they have low energy, low muscle mass, they're weaker, they have decreased libido, they're not sleeping well, they don't feel well, women are having hot flashes, men are getting night sweats, which you can get from low testosterone just like a female would get from low estrogen. So these are some of the common things, and we'll hear from one of my patients who really wasn't making any progress with the synthetic hormones. When I measured her levels, it was as if she wasn't on anything, and she was on pretty high doses from her gynecologist of the standard prescription hormones, and it wasn't until she switched to the bioidentical that her levels became normal and her symptoms cleared up.
Now, when you were mentioning the, obviously you said the gold standard one, the, you know, the jug of urine, this is almost as accurate, but I would assume now, and I don't want to speak for you, but I'm reading into your conversation that this actually would be my situation when they, I think mine was blood they took, again, 35, I'm almost certain it was blood, but if they did one urine test, which would be the standard way, correct? Whatever right. time your appointment is, right. this would, I would assume now, would be more accurate than that, just
yes,
doing one.
Yes, absolutely, because okay. we're getting four different measurements at various times of the day, and there is that normal curve, and you don't want to catch a patient at the high point and say, oh, you're fine, you don't need anything, and you don't want to catch them at the low point and say, oh, you're too low, you need it, when they're actually somewhere in the middle. So this gives us an average of those highs and lows.
Well, let's talk to the people at home. That yes. What's the importance of that? Because you know, it's almost like my scenario, you know, the day I had it, and that's the way I would have been treated, let's say, for a long time. You know, well, you get one test and boom, everything follows that one. Well, what if that was just the weird day? Or in my case, the weird time.
That's a big problem, yeah. Mark. And as you said, we have patients who lift weights and come in after they've done a workout and their enzymes are artificially high. And then we have them come back a day later after they've had water and not worked out and they're completely normal. So if you just rely on one reading, you're going to get yourself into trouble. Specifically, men who come in wanting to be on testosterone replacement, you can't do just one reading and say a man's low in testosterone. Testosterone is not a simple drug to regulate. It has side effects. You have to use it with caution, and you don't want to put somebody on it who doesn't need it. And this really helps identify who needs it much more than a single blood test.
Now, can any allopathic physician, you know, MD, DO,
yes.
Can anybody in your field prescribe bioidentical? That's question number one. Question number two, but not everybody's an expert at it. Correct?
Yes.
I mean, so is it able to be done? I mean, you can go to somebody that just died, you know, a doctor, let's say tomorrow decides, well, I want to do that. Can
well,
you start doing it?
Unfortunately, it's a yeah. problem. As you said, any physician, any practicing MD, DO, PA, NP can prescribe bioidentical hormones, but the problem is not everybody knows what to do with the information or how to prescribe it. So I see a lot of women who come in on bioidentical hormones from their providers, and they're just not making any progress or they're feeling worse, and that's when we do these accurate measurements and get them on the right regimen.
Yeah, just because, we'll go back, you know, when I was in the bodybuilding and all that, you know, just because somebody goes to the gym doesn't make them an expert.
Yes.
And you see, hey, I learned by not being an expert, let's just say that. A lot of the injuries I had, there was no internet back then. You talk to other blockheads. You know, we were all kind of the same. You know,
well, you've seen some of the guys at the gyms who are so-called trainers and, you know, they don't really know a thing about it, but they just look good, so they serve their purpose.
Yes, yeah, and just because somebody works out doesn't necessarily they know working out.
Right.
You know, I still see that. You know, I right. kind of get, in fact, we're doing a show after yours with a fella that has a fitness thing. They're more of a functional fitness. You know, back in my day, they were all hardcore bodybuilding gyms. There wasn't the fitness centers back then. I mean, it wasn't yes. like now. You know, now they're doing functional fitness, you know, where they're... And I would imagine, I'm sure when you deal with hormone levels, you're not necessarily putting the hormone levels back to a 20-year-old, let's say, or something. You might be approximating, correct, going in that direction versus over here. But it's not a full-fledged going back through puberty kind of situation, I would imagine.
Well, you'd be surprised how many patients come in and say, bring me back to a 20-year-old.
Yeah, they want that, but is that smart medicine in your eye?
Okay. No.
And let's talk about why. So we have to educate these guys.
We bring them to safe levels. Okay. Yeah. And you have to be careful. You know, you brought up the older person bodybuilding who wants to be on hormones. I was a reporter for alternative health venues and covered the anti-aging meetings every year. And there were some very famous speakers. And from the distance in a lecture room, you would see these big, huge, well-built guys, and they looked amazing. But when I went up close to interview them, their skin was purple. They had what's called polycythemia, too much blood, thick blood from testosterone replacement. They were totally unhealthy. They had labored breathing. They looked awful up close, but from a lecture room, from a distance, you saw this big imposing physique and you were so impressed.
But they look unhealthy. Well,
up close.
Not only that, they might have looked good from a distance outside. How do they look inside?
I would hate to see these hormone levels or worse yet, their cholesterol, which we'll talk about as well.
But you, I think, were the first, okay, like I said.
True, and we did bring it to Macomb County. In 2001, advanced lipid testing wasn't being done in Macomb County, and I arranged for a lab from Alabama to come to Macomb County and offer it to our citizens. But more importantly, we're still first and foremost on some things, which I'd like to share with the viewers, if I may.
Well, there's a term about you. This was amazing, what the doctor is going to show you next, but is lipidologist the term?
Yes, I am board certified in cholesterol.
I've never heard that. No, I'm not a dumb guy. I know what lipid means.
So in 2005, it was the first year that lipids became a board specialty, just like with family practice or internal medicine.
What does lipids mean?
Cholesterol.
They know that.
Yep.
So when he says lipids, he means cholesterol. So that should get your attention.
So I became board certified in it, and I did it in 2005. Because you can only say you're the first one time. So people have become board certified after me, but I was the first one to do it. So I want to share with viewers, because this is exciting, and I know you liked it when you saw this. One of the labs that we're using, and this patient consented to have his name shown, otherwise I wouldn't show it, but I hated to block out this thing. Patients get this whole huge book when we do an advanced cholesterol test.
And on him.
On just this patient, and there's cutouts of the arteries, and it shows the patient where the different markers are affecting their circulation, their heart. This whole book is unique to the patient. There's diet recommendations based on their sugar and cholesterol. But for viewers who aren't familiar with an advanced lipid test, this
cholesterol.
This is the type of stuff that's shown, which you normally wouldn't see. Patients are used to getting from their doctors the four numbers on a standard lipid test, the bad cholesterol, the good cholesterol, the triglycerides, but they're not used to a breakdown like this. And what they're not aware of is there's different markers that show up on this testing, small dents, LDL, bad cholesterol, lipoprotein A, that are very dangerous. We have healthy young women in their 30s who've had heart attacks with normal cholesterol just on the basis of some of these things, which aren't routinely checked.
It would fly under the radar traditionally.
It would not be looked at. Okay. There's testing that shows if your liver is overproducing cholesterol or if your colon is overabsorbing cholesterol. There's all kinds of information on diet and sugar, but more importantly, this is pretty unique, fatty acid testing. We can measure a patient's saturated fat level, trans fat level, monounsaturated fat, alpha-linolenic acid, and tell them you need more walnuts, you need more olive oil, you need to cut your trans fats. That's all part of this testing. And then they give you cumulative. My patients get excited when they see this cumulative flow sheet at the end of it, because everybody's trying to get as much green as they can. Yellow is in the middle and red is very bad, and patients get excited trying to build up the green. So this is one thing on an advanced lipid test. But a couple things that are unique that we offer that also I brought to Macomb County is one test is called the CORIS test. And this is a unique blood test. If you measure this simple blood test, if a patient scores 15 or less, you can say with 96% certainty, more accurate than a stress test, that there's no blockage of the arteries. So we've saved so many patients from having stress tests and radiation and dye and catheterizations by doing this simple blood test. So this is a great test that a lot of people haven't heard of, and we're doing it here. We're also doing this pulse test, which is unique in that it predicts your risk for heart disease over the next 5 years. It measures 11 different parameters, and if a patient has elevated this particular patient had four times the risk given their age. It measures their heart age, which could be different than our ages, our chronologic age, but it predicts with relatively great accuracy the likelihood of an event. And there's things we can do to intervene when these are abnormal for patients too. So this is just a smattering of some of the things that are done routinely for our patients here, but sometimes in an advanced lipid clinic or a cholesterol center, which we are a cholesterol treatment center. In the 90s, when you first heard of me, I had run the hospital's lipid clinic, and now I'm in private practice, but doing the same type of cutting edge things we did then.
I'm sure your whole basis here, I hate to again talk for you, but I think I can glean into this, and I think this is true in my office as well. There are treatments, but the best treatment of all is to avoid. You know, if you have a massive heart attack and you have to have cardiothoracic surgery or, you know, whatever you guys call it, the best treatment would, don't get the event. You know, try to be proactive versus reactive, I guess would be a
good that's word. Why something like this is so nice.
It's vital.
That actually predicts. And then the treatments to lower these red abnormal risk factors are all relatively natural. Aged garlic and glutathione increasers and meditation and weight training. And those are the types of things that clear this up and lower the patient's risk.
I know you're on cutting edge. And let's go, I'm just going to grab this book.
Yes.
I'll call it a book. When I saw this laying there, I'm thinking, we all get journals. Okay, every doctor on the planet gets journals. I thought this was a journal. I mean, it's so involved, and I'm like, it's just a journal. I don't know why he's got it over there, but it's a journal. Then I see this person's name, and I'm thinking, well, maybe he's the guy writing the journal. And then you come in and said, no, this is about him.
The whole thing.
And journals are this size, a lot of we get. And I'm like, this is one guy, I'm thinking, I've never seen it. I've never even heard anything like this.
And they do such a good job of explaining it for the patients to understand.
I'm sure you have to... To quote my producer, John, you have to cut through the baby talk a little bit. You know, you kind of make it just like lipid cholesterol, you know, so people know that. They don't understand necessarily lipid so much, some might kind of thing. But how futuristically, okay, there's probably a good chance 20 years from now, I hope to work the rest of my life. I know your passion. I think you're looking at it too. But let's say 30 years from now, most likely you're not going to be sitting here. Most likely I'm not going to be sitting here. But what do you see the future? I mean, do you see of healthcare? Do you see that this is still, because you're one of the few, maybe the only that gets to this level, okay?
Right.
What do you think the likelihood is of conventional medicine, let's say, way more doctors out there that will be able to offer this down the road? Or do you think it's still?
Well, that's one reason, Mark, why I lecture throughout the country to introduce physicians to these types of tests so that they can offer it to their patients too. So I have my special interests, as we talked about, with cholesterol and bioidentical hormones, but I have three other providers here in the office in this regular family practice, and they're offering this same. Nobody does a regular blood test anymore. All three of them are conventional family physicians, and they're offering this testing to all of their patients. So it's becoming more and more widespread and more mainstream. But I think it's important, as you said, that we do things prophylactically and preventatively and catch disease early instead of when it's too late and the patient's already had the event.
I remember he used a term called it a kinder, gentler medicine.
Yes.
You still are trying for the same result, I guess, but it was kinder, gentler. Would that apply here as well?
Yes. Well, I'm excited to show you some of the supplements we have on the shelves that we use.
I saw those out there.
And I want to show you some specific ones for heart. So we'll look at those shortly. And I also want to introduce you to Kim, a cholesterol patient who came from elsewhere and really wasn't doing anything because she wasn't motivated by her four numbers on a standard cholesterol test. But when we did the advanced lipid test that you referred to and she saw how much was wrong with her, she really buckled down. She dropped her cholesterol over 100 points. She dropped her sugar well over 100 points. So she's made a lot of progress, and I want to introduce you to her.
And what people need to understand, we got over 7 billion people on this planet. We ain't all going to respond to the same things equally. What works for this patient might not work as well as this one.
That's why it's nice to have so many options, and I'll introduce you to a few of them that are available.
Are there any approaches, you know, Alzheimer's, again, it's a little selfish on my part because it's very advanced, a loved one. We're not winning that battle, are we?
No, and as you know, as we were talking with heart disease and cholesterol, you need to do something before it becomes advanced. So early on, one of the tests available in that book that we've referred to is an ApoE test. And if somebody has an ApoE4, it predisposes them to Alzheimer's disease.
I've never even heard of that.
So when
probably a lot of that I never heard of.
So when we look early for a 59-year-old patient mm-hmm. and find ApoE4, then we can start having patients take fish oil, which is good for the brain, and do crossword puzzles because you want to exercise the brain like any other muscle. And some other supplements, curcumin is very good for the brain, but if somebody's advanced like your relative, it's too late to do those interventions. So that's why we're trying so hard to pick it up early so we can prevent it in the first place. And you've probably heard now, I don't know if your relative has high blood sugar or not, but Alzheimer's is frequently referred to as type 3 diabetes because the link between high blood sugar and later Alzheimer's in life is so huge. It's now thought to be a variant of diabetes.
Your patient you wanted to discuss.
Yes.
Can we go get her now?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Sure.
Let's take a minimal break. We're going to search her out.
Okay.
Seek her out, and it'll just be you and her. I don't need to be in here. You're doing good. So let's do a mini evaluation, whatever you do on your patient.
I would just like you to ask her a couple questions about, you know, how this impacted her. Do you want the hormone patient first or the cholesterol patient
first? Let's go cholesterol.
Okay.
We'll go back to hormones.
Okay. So we're here with Kim, one of our cholesterol patients, and as I referred to earlier, Kim had a standard lipid test and just wasn't making any progress before she had the advanced lipid testing that I showed. So Kim, tell the viewers, you're down 100 points now on your cholesterol,
yes.
And your sugar is so much better. Tell them about the advanced lipid testing and the difference it's made and whatever you want to share with the viewers.
I was non-compliant. But since having the Boston Heart Labs and seeing the book and the breakdowns and everything, it motivated me to want to do better. And
tell everybody your numbers, the change in the numbers.
My numbers have dropped over 100 points. I'm now within the normal range, which is good. And my sugar has also dropped. It's within the normal range now as well.
And viewers should know it wasn't just cholesterol and sugar that was a problem for Kim. Her vitamin D was abnormal. Her homocysteine, which is a risk for stroke and Alzheimer's, that frequently doesn't get looked at enough. Her fatty acids were off. Mm-hmm. Pretty much anything that could be abnormal with Kim was abnormal.
Yes.
And now are almost completely improved mm-hmm. because she's been so much more diligent.
Yes.
So unfortunately, Kim lost both of her parents within a relatively short time, and heart disease runs in her family, and high blood pressure and stroke and all kinds of health issues, which everything identified on her advanced lipid testing put her at great risk. But now we have her sugar. For those who follow hemoglobin A1C, the 3-month sugar, it should be under 6. She was well over 9, and now she's very close to 6 on the sugar. The homocysteine's come down, which is her mm-hmm. risk for stroke, and she has a family history. The cholesterol's down well over 100 points, and some of the other markers for stroke and high blood pressure and heart disease have come down to safe levels for her. Low vitamin D is linked to a lot of problems, and Kim has been much more diligent since having the blood drawn on keeping her vitamin D levels up, which she had neglected previously, and taking her fish oil, and overall her risk for disease is significantly improved. So unfortunately, with Kim having lost both of her parents within a year with no warning, the problem is that these are silent killers, and patients aren't aware that they're setting themselves up for massive heart attacks, sudden death, stroke, Alzheimer's, all the consequences of these things until it's too late. So that's why we try and screen early and treat early so we can prevent all this from happening, and hopefully we can keep Kim along many, many more years past her parents' age. Thank you, Kim, for sharing your experiences with the viewers today.
Thank you.
And keep doing the good job that you're doing.
I will continue to do so.
So we're here with Mary, one of my bioidentical hormone patients. And the interesting thing about Mary is that her gynecologist put her on Premarin and Provera and all the traditional synthetic hormones, and she was on fairly high doses. And when we did her blood levels, they didn't show up. And Mary wanted to do something more natural and have the bioidentical hormones. So when we did her bioidentical hormone measurements, I was able to tell a compounding pharmacy how much of each to mix and put in for Mary. And Mary will tell you how she felt before and after.
Well, in the beginning, I was having a lot of like night sweats. I was having like every 20 minutes, I felt like I was getting really warm. I wasn't sleeping through the night, and I was on the hormones. It took about 21 days before I start feeling like I was actually like flourishing again. My skin felt better. The hair felt better. I just had more energy. And we also found out in the bioidentical testing that my adrenals were off, so he was able to give me some of those also, which I think helped with everything. And I just feel a lot better, and I was happier and had more energy and ready to go all the time, which is the way I like to be. So I liked it.
And would you like to share with the viewers the difference it made in your sex drive?
Well, to me, in a marriage, that's always super duper important. And it's more frequent. There is absolutely no pain. It's pleasurable for everything. And I just think people should definitely give it a try versus taking all the different hormones that are out there and try the bioidenticals and see how they feel. But you have to give it a little bit because it's not a one-size-fits-all. We had to adjust a few things. So you just have to be patient. But if you truly want to feel your best, I highly recommend it. So.
Well, Mary's done great with bioidentical hormones, but I have to tell a funny story about one of our other patients. We have a married couple, and the husband would come in all the time and say, my wife has no sex drive. You have to do something. You have to do something. So she finally came in and did the hormone testing like Mary did, and I put her on hormones. And now the husband keeps coming in and saying, you have to do something. You have to do something. I can't keep up with her.
Yes.
So
yes.
The wife has been doing phenomenally well. Both of them are doing well, but it makes a huge difference in Mary, this other patient, and so many of our other patients as well.
Yeah, it's something.
One of the things that viewers should know is, unfortunately, in the current state of our healthcare system, alternative medicine and bioidentical hormones is usually not covered by conventional insurance. There are exceptions on the West Coast, but in Michigan, it's rarely covered. So patients like Mary and my other patients do have to pay out of pocket for the testing and for the prescriptions, but in some cases, the cost of the whole prescriptions is less than the copay for the synthetic hormones.
But one thing I wanted to add, don't forget, with the bioidenticals, there's different ranges, don't forget. If you just are worried about just your three basic testosterone, estrogen, and progesterone, there's a small kit. But say you want to know about the big kit, which we talked about, your adrenals, your melatonin, they're all in there. So you have options if it's an expense thing, but it's the best money that you could spend because you're going to feel like yourself again, even though we're not as young as we used to be. We don't have to, you know, age that way. We could stay young and grow old gracefully.
Well, thank you. That's a good point. There are degrees of testing. I showed on camera the full testing, which most new patients want to see. But if somebody does have a budget, you can get smaller tests with fewer things just to get started on the basics. But the patients who want everything done for them, like Mary and most of my patients, usually do get the whole testing at least one time so we know the extent of what needs to be replaced.
And just think, you only have to do that one time a year is what he usually does to check. But that one payment that you paid, you're going to have a lifetime filled with fun. And you're just more fun to be around, and you want to like yourself. And I can't say enough about it. So I truly encourage you guys to try.
Thank you, Mary.
Well, Dr. Margolis, we finally meet after
yes.
decades of not even becoming close to meeting. But the reason I had contacted you was just years and years of hearing about you being really cutting edge. And, you know, this is a show that could go on and maybe we'll even come back. You know, I'll talk to the TV station. I know one of them are interested in a lot of things you've said. And it's information that, again, this is one of these shows where probably the first time I'd never heard of bioidentical hormones. And that was maybe 10 years ago, 8 years ago. I never even heard of it, okay? But it's becoming more mainstream, let's say. Mm-hmm. And I know you've been a passionate practitioner of these types of procedures. And I always, like I said earlier, you can't replicate experience. You just can't do it. Whatever you learn in a classroom, as you well know, probably 90% of it, it's just you know, background knowledge, you know, the stuff of on the job and that type of thing. I know we're, I'm sure, going to visit with you again because we only have two topics.
I would welcome
that. There's a lot more topics that you and I, as we get to be a little more conversant, you can educate me even further.
Yes.
But for the people at home, I really appreciate you coming out here.
Thank you.
You're better than advertised, let's say that. And I've never, you know, patients are really appreciative of you. That's how I heard about you, so common patient. If somebody wants to make an appointment or consult the office for an evaluation, obviously a real quick, easy way, you have a website we had just mentioned and a phone number if you could tell people at home.
The phone number is 586-838-2464. And the website is unfortunately long. We've had it redone. It's www.completefamilycareofsterlingheights.com. All one word.
For our viewership, that's not complicated at all.
Good.
Okay. We'll see you next time on 30 Minutes to Better Health.